the Lord a question. I said, don't you do new things on Rosh Hashanah? Then why is it that you are saying that something new is going to begin on the 1st of January 2019? So the Lord answered me. He said, yes, it's true that I always does something new, or new thing is unfurled on during Rosh Hashanah. But this is another new thing that I'm going to do in the year 2019, a new chapter. A new thing is going to be effected that will cause a great momentous change in the entire body of Christ. So therefore, prepare and wait. So a few days later, one of my dear friend, a wonderful prophet from Australia, and I'm sure all Filipinos know him very well, Neville Johnson, he called me and he began to share with me what the Lord spoke to him, asking him to wait on the Lord on 1st January 2019. And that struck a chord in me, because that's the same thing the Lord told me. And he too asked the Lord the same question. Why are you going to do something new on January 1st when you always do something new on Rosh Hashanah? And the Lord gave him the same answer. So the scriptures tells us in Deuteronomy chapter 19 verse 15, Matthew chapter 18 verse 16, 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 19, and Hebrews chapter 10 verse 28, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything shall be established. So the Lord spoke through the mouth of two witnesses, establishing a new thing that He's going to do, which had a first beginning on Rosh Hashanah of September 2018, and it's dual happening on January 1st, 2019. What is this thing that God is going to do? He said, I am coming in a new way to meet my people. Secondly, a new beginning is going to dawn on in the whole world. Thirdly, a new beginning of power and glory is going to be released in the body of Christ that the world is yet to see. Number four, my people shall be equipped with this glory. These are the four things. So when I shared these things with Nabal, he told me, he sounded very surprised, because that was the same four things the Lord had spoken to him, plus these four things coupled together, joined together to mean this thing. What the Lord told Brother Neville Johnson was this: what God is going to do, a new thing that is going to take place, is quite similar to a new effect that happened in the body of Christ during the time of Martin Luther. I'm sure you all know history very well. The beginning of the ministry of Martin Luther brought forth a paradigm shift of a reformation. So what happened then is similar to what is going to happen in these last days, a new reformation of the last days. That's what is effected, a new dispensation, a new beginning of the last days. Not just the end times. The end times is a long expanse of time that actually began when the Lord Jesus Christ was born. But where we are today is the tail end of the end times called the last days. So what is God promising us in this new year or in this new season? He is going to make you see the wonders of His glory. Amen. This is the word that God gave to Moses when He sent him to Egypt. He said, I will cause you to see the wonders of my glory. I will display the wonders of my glory in the nation of Egypt for all the world to see. In the book of Exodus chapter 33 verse 18, we read the prayer of the prophet Moses like this. He prayed very sincerely that he will be allowed to see the fullness of the glory of God. But we read in Exodus 33 verse 20 that his request was not granted, because God said, no one can see my face and live. So obviously, if you prayed a prayer like that and your request was denied, you wouldn't be jumping up and down and shouting, Amen, Hallelujah. Would you do that? No. You would be dead silence, as how you all are deadly silent right now. You're not dead, are you? Are you alive? Okay, by all this sound, I know you are alive. However, we read in John chapter 12 verse 28 that the Lord Jesus Christ prayed a similar prayer like that. He said, Father, glorify your name. And the Father God immediately answered his prayer and granted his request. To one person, it was denied. To another person, it was granted. Why? Does God have favorites? Just a few days ago, one of our ministry partner's daughter came and asked me a question. She asked, does God have favorites? That was her question. An 18-year-old wanted to know that. So if you look at this incident, the prophet Moses was a man dear to the heart of God. To him it was denied. And the Lord Jesus Christ, though Son of God, was yet a man. To him it was granted. What is the reason? The reason is the times in which we are living. The times in which the prophet Moses lived, it was not the season, it was not the times for the glory of God to be manifest in such a clear manner. But the times in which the Lord Jesus was living, it was that season. And the Lord Jesus said that through his death, he has made a way open, so that now we all can see clearly the glory of God in a new manner. Because the scripture says in Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, John chapter 14 verse 9, the Lord Jesus Christ came to reveal the glory of God. So what is going to happen in this season? If you have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to Isaiah chapter 30 verse 26. This scripture is going to be fulfilled. Moreover, the light of the moon will be as the light of the sun, and the light of the sun will be sevenfold as the light of 7 days. In the day that the Lord binds up the bruise of his people and heals the stroke of their wound. See, God is going to do a healing in the body of Christ. And when he begins to heal you, heal the bruises on your body, heal the wounds on your heart, in your soul, when that began to take place, You will lift up your hands, you will lift up your spirit, you will begin to cry out to Him, to know Him in a new way. When you begin to cry out to Him, to know Him in a new way, He will begin to pour forth His glory. Not one-fold, not two-fold, but seven-fold. I am sure you, many of you may have prayed a prayer like this. I myself had prayed that prayer. Most Christians have prayed this prayer like how the prophet Elisha had prayed, Lord, give me 2 times more power than what Elijah had. That's what Elisha prayed. Have you prayed that prayer? Yes, amen, or no, amen? Show me your hands, please. If you have not prayed that prayer, it's okay. It means that you are better Christians, that you don't need any power. Please show me your hands, please. How many of you have prayed that prayer? All right. So most of us have all prayed that prayer, including me. Today, so one day, I was praying this prayer, and I heard the Lord tell me, stop praying this unbiblical prayer. So I was shocked. What do you mean unbiblical prayer? Because it is in the Bible. How can something that is mentioned in the Bible be unbiblical? For a moment, when I heard the voice, I was so sure this must be the devil. Don't you agree? Anything that is not to what we think must always be the devil. Amen. Amen. If we ever hear the voice of God speaking to us, which is not according to what we like, we always say, be gone, Satan. Don't laugh. You do that every day. Amen. So we all do that. So just as I was about to turn around and say, be gone, Satan, with all the Pentecostal power that I had. You know, the Pentecostals really have great power. They can shout at the top of their voice and send an earthquake. That is the power the Pentecostals have. So just as I was about to do all my Pentecostal tactics of doing things, I saw the Lord Jesus standing there. So I was just stopped. You cannot be looking at the Lord and say, be gone, Satan. So I asked the Lord, what do you mean, Lord? How can this prayer be unbiblical? And that's when the Lord Jesus pointed this scripture to me. He said, what I'm going to do in the last days is a sevenfold anointing. Why are you praying for double fold? Amen. Don't pray for double fold. Pray for sevenfold. Amen. 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 From this day onwards, you pray for sevenfold anointing. Amen. So stop praying the Old Testament prayer of double fold. Pray the last day's prayer. Sevenfold. 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 You know, such a glory of God the world has not seen yet. The sevenfold manifestation of the seven spirits of God. Each one of them have a sevenfold manifestation. So can you imagine, each one of the seven spirits of God manifests sevenfold. So collectively, it is 49-fold of the glory of God that will totally rock the entire universe. And on whom is this going to come upon? The Filipinos. Amen. 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 Upon the Filipino children, upon the Filipino youths, upon the Filipino older people, and upon the Filipino men servant and maid servant, come on, shout to your feet and give glory to the living God. Come on, everybody, stand up to your feet and give glory to God. The sevenfold glory of God upon the Philippines. Amen. 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 Please be seated. This is your destiny. This is the will of God for you. This is the plan of God for you. God is going to display the wonders of His glory. Deuteronomy chapter 33 verse 2 and Habakkuk chapter 3 verse 3 and 4. But let's particularly look at Habakkuk chapter 3 verse 3 and 4. And God came from Teman, the Holy One from Mount Paran, Selah. His glory covered the heavens, and the earth was full of His praise. His brightness was like the light. He had rays flashing from His hand, and there His power was hidden. Now in this scripture, you'll find two key words. Now please look at verse 3. In verse 3, the last phrase says, and the earth was full of His praise. So instead of feeling sorry for yourselves, for the mess that we are in, whether your government is good or bad or ugly, whether the conditions in your country are good or bad or ugly, instead of focusing on all the negatives in the land, what should we do? Lift up our hands, lift up our voice, and praise the Lord. Let the whole nation of the Philippines lift up its voice and praise God. Now let's read verse 3 from the Filipino point of view. God came from the man, the Holy One from Mount Paran, Selah. His glory covered the heavens, and the Philippines was full of His praise. Now this is what we should do. From one end of the Philippines to the other end of the Philippines, let all the 7,000 and more islands in the Philippines lift up its voice and praise the name of the living God. Ten years ago when I came, I brought you the word saying, create houses of prayer. Today, 10 years later, I say unto you, create houses of praise. Create houses of worship. Let all the 7,000 islands become houses of praise, houses of worship. When you praise and you worship God, Psalms 22 verse 3 says, it prepares the way for the presence of God, for the glory of God to come down. So when God looks down from heaven and He looks at the Philippines, the entire nation of the Philippines, all the 7,000 more islands should be filled with the cloud of the praises and the glory of God. Now what will praise and worship do? There's something very wonderful and interesting. When I was flying on the plane this morning, while I was having my meal, it is my practice over the last 50 years that I just don't eat alone. I have a company. not in the company of people. They are always noisy. Company of the TV. Because I eat quietly and the TV just talks to me. So I just do all the watching and listening. So I was having a meal and watching a drama on the plane. And I watched a drama series called The Gifted. So what intrigued me or motivated me to watch the drama series was the synopsis that I read in the catalog. And Dr. Bruce Allen will be thrilled to hear this. What I read says, it's a group of young people filled with supernatural powers, and particularly one particular young girl who had the power to open portals for teletransportation. So when I read that, of course, naturally, I remembered Dr. Bruce Allen. Said, oh, I must tell Dr. Bruce about this drama series and ask him to watch that series too. Now, so I watched this drama series, and there was this young girl, maybe just 20. She had the power to create a portal and then open a portal for people to be teletransported from one place to another place. So after the drama was over, I pondered the scriptures about the life of Elijah. Because the scripture says, before the prophet Elijah was supernaturally taken up to heaven alive, he was constantly transported from one geographical place to another geographical place, very similar to what you read in Acts chapter 8 about Philip being transported from one place to another place over a distance of 28 miles. So as I read about these two instances, the incident in Acts says that the Holy Spirit carried Philip. So by that, I surmise that the apostle Philip did not work a miracle, but he received a miracle. Then I looked at the prophet Elijah. In Elijah, it says the Spirit also carries him from place to place. But I began to ponder in my heart, the prophet Elijah possibly could have created a portal for himself and walked through the portal as and when he liked. And how I came to this conclusion was based on what Dr. Bruce Allen always uses to preach in his school of supernatural transportation. In fact, the Lord appeared to him and gave him the mandate for his ministry and for all the wonderful things that he's doing in his life. The Lord told him, you can be teletransported like Enoch by faith. By faith meaning you work it yourselves. You can work it yourself. Of course, you cannot simply do it for your fleshy reason. Oh, I'm so tired and lazy to go to the airport. Let me from my home open the door. I step into Manila. Not for those kinds of selfish purpose. I'm so lazy to get up from my bedroom to go to the toilet, so I open the portal. It doesn't work that way. Everything of God is for the kingdom of God. So it must be kingdom motivated. A good example of this is found in the life of the Lord Jesus. In John chapter 2, when there was a lack for wine, Mother Mary came and told the Lord Jesus, Son, if there's something you can do, a miracle, please do. And the Lord turned around and told his mother, what's your problem? My time has not come. Your time may come. My time has not come. You see, the Lord could have obeyed his mother and worked a miracle there. But he did not do that. If he had done that, he would have worked a miracle in the flesh. But he waited for the kingdom of God's timing. So everything that he did was motivated by kingdom purpose rather than self-centered purpose. This is what we must learn in these last days for the great power that God is going to entrust into the hands of the body of Christ in the last days. Now, as on the 21st of December of last year, as I was waiting before God, I saw a vision. In the vision, I saw the Lord Jesus in the heavenlies holding the rod of Moses in his right hand. Now, when I saw the rod of Moses in his right hand, I was surprised because I imagine, see, this is always our problem. We always have a box theology in our mind and we try to look at spiritual things from our limited perspective or with our limited understanding and then try to interpret spiritual things based on our own understanding, which will always be wrong. So when I looked at this rod of Moses, a thought came in my mind, why is it the rod of Moses in the hand of the Lord when it should be his own rod? It should be the rod of Jesus instead of the rod of Moses. So as I was pondering like that, the word of the Lord came unto me. He said three things. Number one, I will give my rod, the rod of Moses, to my people to do wonders in my name. Just like how the ordinary shepherd's rod of Moses was transformed as the rod of God. If you read in Exodus chapter 3, the prophet Moses had an encounter with God on Mount Sinai. And then God asked him to throw down his rod. He threw down his rod and the rod became a cobra. And then he took the cobra and it became a rod. So it was Moses' rod, shepherd's rod for 40 long years. But in Exodus chapter 3 verse 17, you will read that after the miraculous transformation, it was no more called the rod of Moses, but the rod of God. So it became God's rod. From then onwards till the end of Exodus, it was always the rod of God. So the rod of Moses is also the rod of God. And the Lord says, I will give my rod of Moses too. Now let's localize this for the Philippines. I will give my rod to my people, the Filipinos, to do wonders in my name. Number two, they shall strike the earth. They shall strike the Philippines, waters, and over all the powers of nature to do my wonders. Moses did those wonders over nature, over the waters, and we read in Revelation chapter 11 verses 3 to 6 that when the two witnesses begin their ministry, they also will do similarly of to effect wonders in the nature. Thirdly, I will strengthen my people's bodies to withstand persecution and martyrdom. The sword shall pierce their bodies, but not their souls. They shall triumph in adversity, hunger, and cold. These shall not overcome them. This is how you will be transformed. My dearly beloved, wonderful brothers and sisters of the Philippines, this is your destiny. Amen. This is the plan of God I bring for you today. You need to write this down. How you miss writing it? Get this message. listen it over and over again. Take down, write down all the points, especially all the wonderful, respected church leaders in our midst, and prepare your congregation towards the direction of the destiny of God for the Philippines. God will do wonders and get glory to His name. Isaiah chapter 48 verse 11 tells us He will not share His glory with any other person. When God does wonders to you, please remember one thing. Bend your knees, lift up your hands, and give all the glory to God. Never ever for once, never ever for once even entertain the thought that you did it. The moment you think like that, the glory will be withdrawn from you. You know, I always mention this very, very sad incident in the body of Christ. In the early 20th century, there lived a wonderful man of God in England called Stephen Jeffries. He was powerfully used by God in healings and miracles. Very specifically, he was used by God in healing arthritis and disjointed bodies. Such problems, such sicknesses, infirmities can never stand before his prayers. And such people are always instantly healed and restored back to their original state. So his ministry began to grow on the keeps and bounds, and he was well sought after all over the world, and he became very popular. At the height of his popularity, he was invited to South Africa for a big crusade. When he came to the stage, he saw a sea of crowd numbering several hundreds and thousands of people. And they've all come to hear Stephen Jeffries, and they have all come to be healed in his meetings. So after the worship had finished and the organizing chairman introduced him, so Stephen Jeffries came to the stage, he took the mic in his hand, and he walked right up to the edge of the stage, looking at the sea of crowd, and he said, "The world is under my feet right now." Nothing happened. No lightning, no thunderstorm came down to strike him dead. So the meeting ended as powerfully as all other of his meetings. However, as soon as he went back home, the very sickness through which he had worked miracles to heal people came upon his body. From the crown of his head to the sole of his feet, he was struck with arthritis, and his body became bent down at the waist. He could not lift up his body at all. He was bent down at 90 degrees, and his neck became so twisted, his entire body became so twisted with severe arthritis. Many great, wonderful healing evangelists who lived at that time visited him and prayed for him. But Stephen was never healed. He went to the grave in that twisted condition. His body was so badly twisted that when they made a coffin for him, the coffin was in the shape of a piano. It was that shape so that they could put his 90-degree body in that coffin. That's how he died. Tragic. Why he died like that? Because he touched the glory. You know, no matter what great ministry we do, we all are doing it because of the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. There are many, many wonderful men and women of God here in our midst. And I am sure through you, if not on very large scale, at least in some scale, you have prayed for others and healings and miracles have happened. Now you please answer this question. When you prayed for someone, did you pray in the name, let's say I'm praying, okay? In the name of Sadhu, I pray, be healed. Has any one of you ever prayed like that? No. We always pray in the name of the Lord Jesus, be healed. Have you? So the power and the miracle happens because of the name of Jesus. Not because of my name or your name. If it's not because of our names, then how can we advertise that such and such a person was healed in my meeting? Is this logical? You cannot take any credit. You cannot take any glory. You cannot say, I prayed and he was healed. No, not you prayed. It was the grace of God that effected a healing and a miracle. It's the grace of God. So the end of such a wonderful meeting, what should you do? Just humbly bow your heart. Say, thank you, Lord, for all the wonderful things you have done in the meeting. And we give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. That should be our heart attitude. In the past, many men and women of God have fallen because they took the glory. But this last day's generation should not make the mistake like your predecessors have done. Amen. But God will crown you with glory. In Psalms 8:5, it says God will crown you with glory. He will let you share or indulge in the adulation that the people will give you. Certainly, people hear your prayer. They don't see the hand of God touching a sick person for healing. They see your hand on the sick person. So definitely, people will praise you. People will adore. They will extol you. That is God sharing his glory with you. However, that glory belongs to God. Please write that in your heart. Glory belongs to God. And I can't touch that glory. And how is God going to give that glory to you? The Bible tells us, or the word of the Lord came saying, he is going to clothe his people with glory. How is he going to clothe them? Because the Bible tells us in Psalms 93 verse 1, 104 verse 1, that the Lord God himself is clothed with glory, majesty and honor. And on the 27th of December 2018, I saw a vision. In the vision, I saw the Lord Jesus holding a huge, gigantic, fine linen cloth, and he took it and he covered church buildings, ministry buildings, children, youth, older people, and women with his glory. So upon church buildings, upon ministry buildings, upon youth, children, older people, and also women, he's going to cover you with his glory. And you will do the wonders of his glory. God is going to pour forth a new strength upon the church. God is going to pour forth a new strength into the churches in the Philippines. New wings will be put on it. When this word came to me, I saw small wings being put or fixed in the wrist and on the ankles, which gives you power to do the work of God in a supernatural manner and to travel distances or do the work of God fast. Youths will lift up their wings and arise. These wings are spiritual wings to fly into the heavenly places for warfare. Now new strength will be given to the legs. We read in 1 Kings chapter 19 verse 8 that the prophet Elijah walked in the strength of eating food for 40 days and 40 nights. In the same manner, new strength will be given to the workers of God to walk long distances faster without fainting. This anointing will specifically be given to ministers who are serving God in difficult to reach remote places and mountainous regions. So the Philippines comes under this category. Am I right? You have got so many islands, very difficult to reach. There are also mountainous regions in the Philippines, difficult to reach. Many, many villages, remote jungles, no good transportable roads there, very difficult to reach. God is going to give new strength into your legs that will make you walk faster, that will make you jump up and jump on the mountains, that will cause you to fly, that will cause you to open portals to be transported from one region to another region. Walking on the water will become a common thing. It will become so common that you don't want to talk about it anymore. I heard of a wonderful testimony from a missionary, a German missionary in Papua New Guinea in the Indonesian islands. This missionary used to be the right-hand woman of the world-renowned evangelist Reinhard Bonnke. She was his intercessor. And then God called her to come to do independent ministry and led her to go and work among these tribal people in Papua New Guinea. And she wanted to bring the gospel to them, but when she came there, she realized that they already had heard the gospel supernaturally. You know, this I heard from her own lips. She said, the people of Papua New Guinea worship trees, leaves, and the nature. One day, several years ago, as they were offering offerings to the tree spirits and bowing down before a tree, the tree opened its mouth and spoke to them. The tree said, "Why are you all bowing down and worshiping me when the true living God is Jesus Christ?" They literally heard the tree speak that. They were shocked. They've never heard the name of Jesus. So they spoke to the tree. So who is this Jesus? So then the tree said, "Very soon, a white woman will come in your midst, or a white man will come, and he will show you who is this Jesus." So shortly after that, an American missionary came.
Not at the time when you should bow down and worship the Lord. That is not the time for clapping of hands. You cannot give an applause to God. How can you give an applause to God, the creator of the whole universe? The biblical way to do that is lift up holy hands and bless the name of the Lord God. Not clap hands. That is not proper. That's what happened in many, many churches. The moment they clap hands, they create noise. See, that is the act of the flesh. Spirit and flesh cannot mix together. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. The church, the body of Christ, must learn how to worship God in the beauties of holiness. When you learn that, then the Shekinah glory cloud comes down. Why is it that you read in the Old Testament They were frequently having those kind of experiences. The glory cloud comes down. Today, we have very good singers, musicians, great equipments. All, every one of us are filled in the Holy Spirit, not like in the olden days where the kings, the prophets and the priests are only filled in the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says the new covenant Christians are better than the old covenant Christians. Agreed? If that is true, then the new covenant Christians must experience greater glory than the old covenant Christians. But why is it? We are not experiencing anything. Something is wrong somewhere. The problem is, we do not know how to worship God in spirit and in truth and in the beauties of holiness. There is a place to jump up and down, to dance and sing like King David. There is a place for all that. I don't deny all that. However, there is a place where you bow down, you prostrate, and you worship and reverence God. You know, in charismatic Christianity, the worship that we know is singing songs. But that is not what worship actually means. Worship means you bow down, you reverence God, not singing songs. You are bowing down, you are just reverencing the holiness of God. That is what the word worship strictly means. Of course, we can bow down at His feet and sing songs of love, songs of adoration, like the song that our brother Porter led us to sing now, "How Great Thou Art." We can do all that. But you know what it means when He says worship the Lord in spirit and in truth? It involves body worship. Charismatic Christianity doesn't know that. The only body worship that we know is clapping hands and jumping up and down. But there is a body worship of prostrating before the Almighty God. Lifting up holy hands, standing up to your feet, not sitting down and worshiping God. How can you do that? Read the book of Revelation. Every time the saints in heaven, the elders in heaven, the angels in heaven, they worship God, they are either standing up or on their faces before God. No one will be sitting on the chair and worshiping God like we do in our churches today. It's a mockery. This is the reason why we are not experiencing the glory of God in our churches. Because we are not worshiping God in the beauties of holiness. The Spirit of the Lord, when He manifests, He'll bring an awesome glory of God in our midst. Now let us look at some of the manifestations of the Spirit of the Lord. One particular supernatural manifestation of the Spirit of the Lord is in the supernatural transportation, both bodily and in the spirit. That is the work of the Spirit of the Lord, where He supernaturally transports you in the body from point A to point B, or you are supernaturally carried, transported in the spirit, even across time dimensions. Have you heard of time travel? It is absolutely possible only in the spiritual realm, not in the natural realm. Don't believe all the Hollywood movies. The principle is true, but not the practicality. It is only possible in the spiritual realm. Let me give you a few examples. How does this work? You see, when a flood comes, whatever is along its path, it will wash away, it will carry away. Am I right? Likewise, when the Spirit of the Lord comes like a flood, He will just wash you, carry you up along its path, so that you will travel, you will go wherever the Spirit of the Lord wants to carry you and bring you to. Now let me give you five scriptural examples in the Holy Bible of what I'm just sharing with you. Firstly, Enoch. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 5 verse 24, and Enoch was translated by God. You remember reading that? Now the word used in the King James Bible is, and God took him. Please take note of the word took. The Hebrew word for took means caught away, carried away. He was caught or carried away by the Spirit of the Lord, bodily translated from this world to another world. Now let me correlate that with another example. Philip, in Acts chapter 8 verse 39, it says that as soon as Philip finished baptizing the eunuch from Ethiopia and gave him some last little instructions about walking in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit carried him bodily from the wilderness into another city where he was found later. Now the Greek word used carried away is the same word used in the Hebrew for Enoch being taken by the Lord. It was the Spirit of the Lord that carried them bodily, Enoch and Philip. Secondly, Elijah. If you read 1 Kings chapter 18 verses 44 and 46, after 3 years of drought, now the time has come for the rains to come. So Elijah, after having unbounded the heavens, then he declared to King Ahab, you better fasten your chariot and you better rush home because a mighty outpouring, downpouring is coming. Better run home. So King Ahab got into his chariots and he began to whip up his horses and they began to run as fast as they could for their dear life. Have you heard of horsepower? Now, can any man outrun a horse? No. Technically impossible, right? Everybody agrees? In 1 Kings 18:46 says, and the hand of the Lord came upon Elijah and carried him, and he ran faster than the chariots and reached the town before King Ahab came in his chariot. How is that possible? The hand of the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord lifted him up, and like a hovercraft, he just flew. You know, it seems like he was running, but his feet will not touch the ground. When the feet doesn't touch the ground, there's no more friction, right? There's no more friction. The Spirit carries you, and you are running, flying, guiding, all taking place at the same time. See, he had a bodily translation. Bodily translation. Thirdly, the Lord Jesus Christ. If you read John chapter 6, verses 15 to 21, the Lord Jesus Christ came walking on the water. How is it possible? We always heard that it was the rules of nature, the laws of nature were suspended because he is the maker. Not true. When the Lord Jesus Christ was on this earth, he was as human as you and me. He was anointed with all the 7 spirits of the Lord. And it was the Spirit of the Lord that upheld him, that he was able to walk on the water. Now, this is the interesting part, which you may not have seen before. The disciples were in the boat, and they were seeing the Lord Jesus Christ walking towards them. When, as soon as he stepped into the boat was transported to the shore where they should go. The boat plus the 12 disciples and the Lord Jesus were all transported by the Spirit of the Lord to the shore. Do you believe what I said? Some of your look shows that I'm quoting not the Holy Bible but my own Bible. So, to quell all your doubts, please turn with me to John chapter 6. John chapter 6, look at verse 21. Then they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they went. Immediately, in an instant, the boat was transported. Bodily transported to the land where it should go. There is no limit to the Spirit of the Lord's blast of power. no limit. We have not known the power of the Spirit of the Lord yet. Whatever we have known in the Bible is just flimsy, child's play accounts of the Holy Spirit's power. Now, I have given you 4 examples of bodily transportation. Now, I will give you 2 examples. But before I give you 2 examples, let me quote, narrate to you a real life incident that can take place today to any one of us. I have a dear prophet friend in South India. One day, he was praying and waiting on the Lord. And he heard the voice of the Lord Jesus Christ talking to him, giving him some counsels and some instructions. And when the presence of the Lord departed from him, he remembered that the word of the Lord that was given to him is from some passage in the Bible. And he wanted to refer to the whole context of what the word says. So he tried to look for his Bible, and he realized his Bible was not in his bedroom. They were in the living room. So he thought to himself, now all this is real in the natural, not any vision. So he thought to himself, let me rise up, go to the living room and get my Bible. Do all bedrooms have doors? They do, right? So if you want to go from your bedroom to the living room, you must open the door, right? That's what normal people do, don't they? Any of you do differently? So he got up from his bed and he walked through the door, picked his Bible and walked back through the door, came and sat on his bed, opened the Bible to read the passage of scripture that the voice of the Lord read. Suddenly, it dawned on him, he just walked through the door, picked his Bible, and he walked back through the door. Even the Bible walked through the door. When he narrated this incident to me, I just marveled. I then brought this remembrance. I said, you know, not only you walked through the door, even the Bible, man-made Bible, even that Bible walked through the door. Tell me, what limit is there to the Spirit of the Lord? There's no limit at all. Now let me give you 2 examples about being taken up in the Spirit. Firstly, you will read about Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter 8 verse 3 and chapter 11 verse 24, 2 specific instances are mentioned in the Bible when the Spirit of the Lord came down and caught up Ezekiel and brought him in the Spirit to see visions. He was taken into the temple and to see gross sins that are being done in the secret. Taken in the Spirit and took to places. Not just you are out of the body and you're seeing a vision of God, but been transported from one point to another point.